Oh, that's good. I think that Bender is great for 3D printing when you use it at the right moment. So today I want to talk about what is the right moment and when is it not. So I will compare Blender versus CAD. CAD is computer-aided design programs like SolidWorks, Siemens NX, Onshape, CATIA. Are people familiar with that kind of software? Okay, good. So I'll talk about 3D printing as well. And 3D printing comes in many different forms. So you have the small printers you can buy yourself, have at your home, they're really fun. And they have more high-performance printers, and that's where I'm working with. So I work at Bond, Bond 3D, and we make printers such as that one for high-performance polymers. And high-performance polymers, you might not say something. Here's C1. This is PEEK. And so it's basically plastic that has very good properties and is very expensive as well. So what is PEEK? It's very light, it's very strong, it's chemical resistance. So it means that it can get in your body for implants and it doesn't hurt your body, which is very useful if you want an implant, of course. But also being used in aerospace due to the strongness and lightweight or semiconductor industry. So within Bond, we use, of course, software because we need files. We do two things. First of all, we create a printer, which you see here. And we need files to design the printer. And we also need files to, test the printer. So we need files to print. And I want to talk about what kind of the requirements are for each of this application and what the difference is between Blender and CAD. So let's start off with the printer, because that's our main business, of course. And so for every design process, there are many different models of how your design process looks like. There are whole universities, all studies of how design process looks like. I just summarized this to three simple steps. If you design a machine, you have to need to design, you need to evaluate, and you need to produce. Especially evaluate is very important. A machine never gets designed on the first time right. It just doesn't happen. You're all creators. Whoever creates something here that's perfectly the first time? None, right? So these are the requirements, and I want to talk a bit about some important there ones. So relationships to lockability. Once you design a machine, which machines are normally made in CAD, what happens traditionally is you make a sketch, very 2D. You define every single relationship. If it's not everything completely defined, then it gets blue and says, hey, not good enough. Go fix it. So you define every relationship, every size. Like the circle you see here, the circle, it's not in the first picture. It is a circle, it has a size, but doesn't have a location compared to the rest. So once you define every single parameter, someone's going to check every single parameter. And once it's checked, it's being locked, and then you're good to go. What's the difference between the relationship and the definition? In Blender, we say, OK, I want this shape, this size, this location, it's done. For a machine, in CAD, what often happens is you say a relationship. So I have this circle, and I'm placing it in the center. Or I'm placing it at the distance between the corner. And then I'm going to stretch the square, because I have to redesign, as always. And what happens? Is your circle going to stay in the middle, or is your circle going to stay on that position? And there's a big difference in Blender and CAD. It's a relationship. So you don't say it's a dimension. No, it's a relationship to something else. And you have to think, when you're giving every single parameter, you have to think, so what is important here? If I have to change it, how will it go? And it's something that Blender is lacking. And I already told you that everything will need to be adjusted. So here's an example, and this actually happens in this manifold. You have this tube, and the diameter has to change on the inside. Well, in CAD, that's not an issue. It's one of the many parameters. You change it, it's done. In Blender, you better hope that you model something and gave it with a modifier thickness. Otherwise, well, good luck. And what happens is, of course, that everything else has to stay exact same. And maybe this model is not just this model, but it's part of a large assembly, and everything else in assembly is already checked and needs to stay locked. So you cannot just open a file and adjust it, so you need the file management system. So it's a very important part, is adjustability. And Blender is not always very, you have modifiers, but it's not like a complete design history you have in most CAD programs. And last point is communication. And this is one that I always kind of forgot about. Because a 3D file is not just a design. It's actually an idea written as a communication to others. People just think, oh, it's a file, it's a design, that's it. But no, it's just a 3D representation, it's a model. It's not actually, it's just information, but it's communication. And what happens is that when you're making a machine, you're not designing everything from scratch. You're not going to design every single screw that you're using. It's already there in the library. Just like you're not going to make every texture in Blender ever again. You know, you use libraries. And the important thing is that you talk with something. You want to CAD can import your Blender library textures. But also, all the screws that are already there, that are already designed, all the single components, all electrical components, they're being available in STEP and IGES. Go to a component, say, hey, I want an STL file or a blend file, and people will, what's that? So that's also something very important. And it's not just importing, it's also exporting. Because the designers are not going to make the machine. Well, I hope they don't, because it's a lot of, it's so many things, different things you need to know. So your vendor, that is the one that's going to make it, and they want either a 3D file or a 2D file. And I always found it kind of backwards, you know? You have a 3D file and you need 2D? Are you seriously? I have the file, go print it. I'm a 3D printer, so. But some people actually don't even have a computer there. If you see in the picture, this is how some things are made in machine designing. Your metal plating, that's not the 3D, you don't need 3D for that, and they want a 2D drawing. And I went, after working at Shapers for a couple of years in 3D, I went to a normal engineering company and I had to make 2D files. And I was really like, I don't want to do this. Such a bullshit. but then this very old engineer, he checked all my work. It was such a lot of work, such a lot of improvements I had to do. And he told me about the communication. I was like, OK, I got your point. And there are also a lot of things that are in 2D drawing that are not in 3D. For example, all tolerances, like what is important, how exact does a size need to be? It's very important. Surface things, it's all machine-related stuff that as a 3D modeler I don't really care about. But for production, it's very important. And this is also something that, yeah, you need your software really made for it. So the question is, if you really want to, can you still do a Blender? Can you just write add-ons and add-ons and add-ons? Some people are trying. Little things, but the question is, should you? Because if you're just using Blender because it's free and CAD is so super expensive, thousands of euros per license per year, there's a lot of free CAD tools as well. They have more, they have the relationships, they don't have all the tools you want, but I still would not say design a whole machine in free CAD software because it's still lacking, you know, machines are complex. There's also something else. Because I think Blender and CAD are so fundamentally different. The question is, should Blender do everything? I'm not the first one to compare Blender to a pocket knife on this conference. But I think at some point, you just want to maybe ask too much of a tool, and then it becomes useless. And I think as an engineer, you better have a toolbox and just pick out the right tool every time you need it. So I would say for machine building, don't look at Blender. You know, make sure that everything is lockable and everything is great. Just don't do it. But still, I like Blender. Otherwise, I would not be here, right? I mean, I'm an engineer. I'm supposed to be very critical, so that's why I'm talking all the time. Oh, not good enough, but I actually really like Blender. And that's not just because I don't like CAD. Well, CAD is just so much work, you know? You have all these parameters. You know how much time it takes to define all and to have to check everyone and to lock it. And then you have this whole great design history, so you can change every step you did. But you know what happens if you change something at the beginning? You get a shitload of bugs. So you change something in 5 seconds, you're so happy because, oh, it's done, it's great. And then you spend 15 minutes fixing all the bugs that you caused. But also, that there are good things that Blender really does well. And that's, of course, visualization and animation. And if you have to convince someone that things will look good, then visualization is always important. There's also something really nice, and that's the more organic and the complex shape design. That's something CAD is very square, you know? Everything is a straight line, and curves are annoying because curves are hard to define. So everyone got likes things square. And if you want to have something more complex and organic, then Blender is your friend. And it brings me to the next part, because where is complex and organic shapes really relevant? That's designing for printing. Because the great thing about printing is that complexity is free. So you can design something so complex as you want, and the printer doesn't care. The printer doesn't care if it's a straight line or a curve. The printer just prints, and that's great. For example, what you see here, it's actually just a show off, saying we can print really small porous structures. And you don't want to make this in CAD, but it's very, yeah. This is actually part, the structure, of a spinal cage. And spinal cages are implants in your back. And those kind of things, medical implants, they need more organic shapes because nothing in your body is straight. Try to find a straight line in your body. Good luck with that. So then, then it's nice to have a more complex way of modeling. So once again, here is the simplified design process. You want to design, you want to evaluate, and you want to print. And Blender has a lot of great things here. So you can have, first of all, like I said, the freedom of your form. You can make those complex shapes, and you can make them very easily. It's very quick. Don't have to define everything, just it looks good. The size is good, great. It's so fast. Then you have to evaluate. And this is the thing with 3D printing. On the screen, everything looks great. You know, on the screen, every detail looks sharp. You can zoom in and zoom in and zoom in. Your details, they're still there. That's great, right? Well, that's not reality. Because as soon as you print, you will find out that most printers have pretty low resolution and that all your details are gone. And there's a huge gap between, especially for first beginners, there's a huge gap between what you think you're going to get and the print you're actually going to get. 2D or screen is just never reality. So the best way to evaluate your 3D design is to just print it. And well, that's great if you're going to print anyway. So that's great. And also, the printer talks the same language as Blender, SCL files. Great. It's very quick, everything. Of course, there are still some disadvantages. Those fundamental changes later on, the inside of your tube, that's still a problem. That doesn't go away. So you still have to think about what is going to change later on. Because also prints, they're going to change very fast. And then sometimes what happens a lot in more mechanical settings is that you need to do some simulations. You need to see what power breaks my model. So you're going to run a simulation. And those programs, well, they're used to CAD files. They don't know STLs. And STL and mesh, what's that? I want volumes. I want calculations of volumes. Blender doesn't work there. There are, of course, importing and exporting and everything, but that's just a disaster. And print is not always finished. 3D printing is real great, but like I said, the bad resolution, this means that sometimes someone needs to add details later, like adding threads. And then, well, I'm not going to do it. I did it. Stupid work. So I'm just going to give it to someone else, and he or she needs to know what's happening, so I still need a drawing. So that means, putting something on paper, you know? So now I want to show you some like a real-life inside the company, inside Bond. So what did we do with Blender? How can we apply it? And this is one of the main parts I've been working on. It's a demonstration part. So our machines, we're almost going to the market. We want to show off what we can do. So we're really proud of what we can do. And we're doing for this the semiconductor industry. That might not say so much, semiconductor industry, but it's the industry for the computer chips. So in ASML we have in the Netherlands, they have monopoly on making the machines that make the wafers that are chips on. So it's a huge industry in the Netherlands. And what you really need to know about this industry, everything needs to be very precise and very clean. And cleanliness, clean room, clean, you know, we have different grades, and that's a very important thing. So if you have a demonstrator like this, where with tubing, it's very important that nothing in the tube goes in or out. If I have liquid under pressure there, liquid should not leak, but also the air should not get in. So as a demonstrator, we need to show that we can put a lot of pressure on these things and nothing happens. We also say we're using PEEK, so super strong material, so we need to prove that it's actually strong. And well, how do we do it? Of course, by blowing the part up, because that's the most fun way to show that you can do things. Well, to blow it up, we do this analysis. So what we do is we add a lot of pressure, and we check in reality, like how much pressure did the break. Then we do a simulation, and we say, okay, if we use this much pressure, what material strength, is this material strength that we say it is? Because that's one of the things 3D printing, you put a material in there, and the people were, yeah, but can we trust the technology? Can we trust that you have that all the layers are completely melted together and it's not weaker than the original material? So do this analysis. Also, we need some exact measurements, the inserts, the interfaces with the rest, they tend to change because the deliverance is too long, so we need different connectors. And therefore, therefore, this part was actually not really fitted to use. We needed a cut file in the end. That's the only real conclusion we could draw. But it's not the only thing we need. Because when you want to show off a model, you also want to make it make sure it looks good. So there are a lot of shape iterations, a lot of things like, does this apply, does the user, our potential customer, do they understand what it is? And if you don't understand what the manifold is, I can get it. I don't know how many mechanical engineers are here. But we need to show that you can connect a lot of tubing and everything goes right. But also, we need to design a support structure. And if you're a bit known in 3D printing, the first thing you learn is you cannot print in air, you know? If you're if a shape like this, and you just print it without nothing, then at some point, the printer will have to print mid-air. Well, that doesn't happen. Material doesn't float. So you need a structure to support it. And there are some requirements for this, because you need to remove it. So first of all, you need to be able to break away the model, the material from the model, and then it should be okay. But you don't want the support material to touch the model on the lower end of the ellipse, because then when you break it away, you have extra surface disruptions, and you don't want your surface to be as clean as possible. So you need to have a different shape, and also it needs to be strong, because during the printing process, a lot of forces are applied, not just the printing head, but also the shrinkage of material. And the bigger you get, the more it shrinks, that creates a lot of forces. So we did a lot of testing. And, they failed. Number one, you can see the interface between the model and the material, the support structure, is still intact. The support structure broke. Number five, very strong support structure, so strong that the model broke. But actually, all of these failed because this is just a very cheap plastic print. But then when we did it on peak, what happened was that all the forces were too big and they were all swept away by the printer. And then you get this big blob of plastic. So just for something as simple as a support structure, a lot of different iterations were required. So we test, print. If I had to do it all in CAD, it would have taken me forever. But finally, we found something that worked. And this isn't even actually the final one, because since then it has changed. But I did have to remodel everything afterwards in CAD. Why? Because, the model was in CAD, and the interface between the model and support structure, it was likely to change, and actually it did. So I was very happy that I remodeled in CAD, because then the interface between those two things, they changed with it. Those relationships that CAD has, it's great. So what I did, instead of just using Blender for the final product, I used it in part of the design process. So I used it as a concept for the concept creation with the 3D model. Here, Blender was great. And in the detailing phase, that is where I would use SolidWorks. And that's the next question, because 3D printing, it's great, but it's not like the only physical product design that's being done. The print is sometimes the product, the final product, like the demonstrator, but often it can be designed for part of the design process. And actually, printing has a lot of applications here. That print is the final product is not that common. I mean, we at Bond tried it, of course, because we're having these very high performance prints, so for us, it's always supposed to be the final part. But I just want to look a bit besides Bond, so how can it be a different place? So here we have the complete design process. Again, it's a simplified version of whatever design process you can have. And every step, you can use 3D printing. And every step with this printing, sometimes Blender is a very useful way. So analysis, you always start with the problem, you know, you need to fix. And in medical situations, what sometimes happens is that you 3D print to just get the situation. You have this very nice skull here. And this is an actual 3D print from Stratasys. Most prints are not that complicated, not that fine. It's just like a big show of model. You find it at every fair. But you can just analyze things, medical situations, because they're very hard to grasp without visualization. And sometimes people print it just to get to prepare for the surgery, to see what do we need to do. Also, the next phase is often, after you know what your problem is, you're going to do some ideas. And in consumer products, a lot of form studies are done. Like what I said about the screen, the difference between the screen and physical product, the best way for consumer products, if it needs to be handheld, is to just have prints. So for this, prints and Blender go very well together. Just having ideas, just like 2D sketches, but then in 3D, then Blender is great. It goes very fast. The concept already talked about, you can make ideas very tangible. But also in detailing, it's often where you go to cut, you can check the feasibility of small details, like this 3D printed lid. Just see if things fit, just see if it works if you want to pour water. Instead of doing a very expensive simulation, you can do it like this. And then there's testing. And before 3D printing was called 3D printing or additive manufacturing, it was called rapid prototyping. That was the first application of 3D printing. And today, that's still one of the main applications there is. So you just test the product before you start a whole injection molding process. So what we want to show you is that 3D printing and Blender, they go hand in hand very well, but maybe not for a final product. It's more that when you have mechanical, if your part has some mechanical requirements on the end, so like machine building or simulations, you need to go to CAD. At some point, you just have to. But before you go to CAD, before you're there, you can use Blender to iterate, to be fast, to think of ideas. In every design step, you can use Blender, and it's going to save you a lot of time. And it's not just for 3D printing, it's an overall design, physical design process. So I really hope that you learned today is that together, CAD and Blender can make sure that physical product design can go a lot faster. Thanks.